Senator Roach, please come to the podium. We're so glad to have you here today.
Well, thank you very much. I don't know if this is a podium. I feel like I'm
well, not
ready
a
to take off, you know. Not sure that, or I'm, you know, in the Star Wars circle here. But that's okay. I understand these break up and do other things. Thank you so much for having me today. As you know, I just got back from Panama a few weeks ago and had a wonderful experience learning. It was a quick trip. Went in on a Wednesday, woke up early in the next day, went out and looked at the canal, the current Miraflores, and then to see the new locks. And then went to American Chamber of Commerce, went to the embassy, and then next day flew home. So it was very quick. I'd been there before. I had no desire to stay much longer. But I went because I chair the committee that deals with ports, the Governmental Operations Committee. I was asked to go as the only legislator west of the Mississippi. It was the CSG, Council of State Governments East, that actually sponsored the trip. So there were legislators there from Georgia and from South Carolina, and they were delighted. They were having a great time. Wow! You know, it's like candy shop time. And I don't know. It was manna from heaven that I got to go. I'm not sure. The majority leader asked me to go. I do pro tem the Senate and I'm on a trade policy committee, and so I guess that's why. So I don't want this to be a travelogue, but I do want you to have an opportunity to see some of the things that I saw. We'll run through it quickly. Love to take questions. I only have a few moments. In the end, I will give you some suggestions of things I think that we might want to consider to do together. Okay, so let's see here. This, of course, you know where it is. Now, I've done a lot of traveling. I've been to 50 countries, and I've been all through Central America. I've been to a number of ports, not as many as you have, but I've been to Long Beach with Ron Sims when I was council aide to Kent Pullen. I've been to, you see Honduras there. I have a nonprofit there. Puerto Cortez, Honduras, is in the north area there, and they're looking, to, by the way, to build a dry canal, which would mean porting there on the Pacific side using highways to get their goods over to Puerto Cortez and then up into the other areas. I've been to certainly San Diego. The difference between their harbor and ours is you can actually fall overboard and live, you know. Here you frickin' freeze to death. So anyway, pretty salient difference. This is what the real tight Miraflores locks are like today. And here, they break loose. Once you get into the locks, which, of course, are all man-made, of course, but a lot of this is also man-made. There's a huge lake in the middle, so there's free-flowing. Once you get through the locks, everything is good. This is the group, a very small group. Some of those people are staff members, and then you have CSG East. I already covered some of that. And as that as well. And this is a picture you'll see if you're on the vessel going through on a cruise ship. And that's what it looks like. That's the old canal built over 100 years ago. You see, it even looks narrow to the eye. So this is the Panamax size. That's what you get. Now, we build ships to the route. So you'll have some that are built to go through the Suez Canal. You'll have some that built Panamax. You'll have some that go around the Cape Horn of Africa. When this new lock is finished, and it's scheduled to open January of next year. Most people think it won't exactly open then, but it's 99% finished. I can attest to that, you'll see pictures. This is, again, the older lock, and this is the new one. Now, this thing is absolutely huge, all brand new. There's still construction at the site. We had an opportunity to put on our hats that says, the Port of Panama or whatever it says on the hat, and just stand in awe of this whole thing. They explained all this, how this works and so forth. This is part of the new canal. This is the entryway into the lock. This gives you an idea of how big this will be. So you were talking about the TEUs a little earlier. Somebody mentioned it. So this lock will be 13,000, 14,000, existing only 4,400. So it's a complete, it's huge. And Then they gave us a nice presentation. This one talks about the routes. They are constantly and very hardworking in terms of looking for customers. And those customers are coming from, as you can, I don't know if you can see too well on the slide, maybe, but you can see the swath of where they feel that they're going to be drawing. And you see six round circles, those round circles, Asia and so forth, where they're going to be getting their customers. This is another way, competing for cargo from Asia. You get an idea of who's doing the competing. Now, this is the show that they provide to visitors. This was provided by the Port Authority there, the canal zone, if you will. So I wanted to talk a little bit more before I go into that to tell you that I think the issue of the ports is really, you know, like the general population doesn't know much about it. You'd ride by and say, isn't that pretty? Look at those big cranes. Heretofore, I might have said, gee, what kind of security is there? And I've also toured the Port of Vancouver, a three-day tour, and it dealt with security of the you know, the all the water and the ports. You saw the dogs, you saw the tunnels, you know, the whole thing, and you could see through the containers and that sort of thing. So there's a lot going on at these ports. But the biggest thing that we have to worry about here is what's going to happen to our deep water port, and will they be viable as soon as these huge, three times what they're carrying now, can go through the lock? And so I feel like that time is of the essence. I feel like we all need to work together. The Northwest Seaport Alliance is certainly the third largest port in the country now. And we need to be competing, and successfully so, with not only the Panama Canal, but Prince Rupert and Long Beach. And these are things that I think should be expedited. So I'm going to give you a few ideas. First of all, I think we should take a tour of the lock. When I got back, just like the day after, I mean, I've been working on other subjects. Fantasy football has been one, you know, of trying to extract the little guy and the game of skill and let the game a chance people do their own thing. Just want to help, that's all. You know, half the males, half the people in the state of Washington are males, and I think this is a good place to go. So anyway, there I was with the film crew, and as they were setting up, I mentioned I just got back from Panama. I told him about the trip real briefly. He says, well, we'd like to go with you. We'd like to go down. So we'll pay our way. So you already have a cameraman and his crew person who would like to go down. And this is really a good opportunity because we, in order to be successful, we've got to build the profile. You got to sexy this thing up a bit. No one knows about it. No one really knows about what's going on at the Panama Canal. They do not know what the competition is like. They do not know what they're doing at Prince Rupert right now, which is huge in terms of getting their cargo and onto the rail and out of there. Nobody knows this. And so I think that one thing I've done fairly successfully in the last 25 years, I have won 7 four-year terms, and they've been tough races. You have to market. And you have to get out there, and you have to make your issue the ones that is important. So I would like to pursue this if you're interested. How many have been to the Panama for a tour, not just going through on a cruise? Okay, then that leaves several that haven't. That means 7 people have not. At least we don't know what the other 2. The harbor maintenance fee. Now, in my preparation for meeting with you and just for my committee work, I've been meeting with a lot of people. That would include labor. That would include longshoremen and building and construction trades council. It would include business, people that want to have a new terminal or have access to a terminal. It includes people who would like to just make that financial investment and so forth. And repeatedly it comes up, the harbor maintenance fee. So, you know, we pay into it, we get nothing out of it. We have a deep port in on the Caribbean. They don't. They don't have that. They have to dredge. So my statement here, get us in or get us out. Either get us in that and get us some money, Congress. That means our legislators, our congressional members here in Washington State need to work on this. They need to pal up with people from Oregon and other places. If they make this a priority, they can get it done. And if you can't get us any money, then get us out of it. because we have to be competitive, and we can't do that when we're being sucked. I would say it's sucked dry, but, you know, it's a lot of water we're talking about. So the next issue is vesting. And one of the things, almost immediately after I got back, and this will tell you when I went, turned on the TV, and there is a situation where you have, I think it was Foss, who was going to lease a spot on one of your terminals, and Shell Oil came in. The city of Seattle says, well, we're going to revoke the permits and so forth. Now, this is a very timely subject. If you'll look in your book, please, I hope you will. I believe I had your kind staff here put in this article. And it has to do with what is new investing, and it's extremely important. I mean, I suppose for the state, but let's talk. Well, I'm only talking ports with you. First paragraph, August 25th, that's just like 2 months ago, the State Court of Appeals issued a significant decision regarding the vested rights doctrine. The court held that the doctrine is entirely statutory, with the statutory doctrine replacing rather than supplementing the common law vested rights doctrine. For the first, in the first sentence of its opinion, the court states, and this is what's important, Washington's vested rights doctrine originated at common law but is now statutory. So the legislature will hold the key in how we're going to be defining this. It's very important that we not let this short session go by without a proposal or two. And I'm working on some of those. Would love to have your help. I've got, again, limited time. Northwest Seaport Alliance report to the legislature. A couple of years ago, and I lose track of time, I was also chairing the committee, and I had interested people from both ports come in, and we were talking about the formation of this thing called the Northwest Seaport Alliance, and we were glad to hear what you were going to do. You've done it. You've accomplished it. We'd love to have you come down probably the first week of session, report to the legislature. Oftentimes, these meetings are on TVW, so it gets a little broad, more broad circulation. And I want that. We have to have that for our subject matter. So these are a few things that I think might help, and love to hear some of your ideas. We're all competing for customers out there, and to be able to do that successfully, I think it belongs first with the people of the state of Washington. Are they going to want to support an effort that would help us be competitive and actually win when it comes to the contest? Do you have any questions?
Yes. Thank you so much, first of all. I just want to say, I want somebody on staff to get her a hat that says Northwest Seaport Alliance Ambassador, because that was the best pitch. Thank you, Senator.
Well, thank you.
I really, really appreciate it. I mean, no, honestly, the fact that you can go out and advocate for all the things that we talk about in plain English, if we could just send you across the state, we would appreciate it. But talking to your colleagues in the Senate in particular. So we'll absolutely take you up on the report to the legislature. I think our staff should look into the vesting issue a little bit more. That's new to me. And I just want to talk about two things. The idea of taking a trip to Panama is brilliant. A few years ago, the Cascadia Project did a trip up to Prince Rupert, and I think Commissioner Meyer was on that, and Commissioner Elbro from Port of Seattle. And I had encouraged the sponsors of that trip to include labor, and that really had some great connections. And they, when you see it firsthand, it has a much different impact than just sort of hearing about it conceptually. So I love the idea, and we'd love to have you advocate with your colleagues to join on a trip.
Let's try to work that. The cost, the press would pay its own way. It's very inexpensive. Like I said, I've done a lot of travel there. So you can go down for like $700 or less. You can fly down there, usually through Houston, but there are other ways. And the rooms are very inexpensive. $150 gets you a very nice room. The group down there that does these tours will have a van. We'll have a small group. If it's large, we have more. So thank you. I'd like to help put that together, and I think it will be helpful in getting us on the map. Thank you. Any other?
I think Commissioner Creighton and then Meyer. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Senator, for a great presentation, and every one of your points, I think, is totally worthwhile. I totally agree with, and Commissioner Bowman beat me to the punch mentioning the Cascadia trip up to British Columbia, but I would recommend that we ask them to do that again.
Yep.
I think every few years, because, you know, British Columbia, Prince Rupert, as you pointed out, and Vancouver are huge threats to us, even possibly more so than the East Coast ports through the Panama Canal. So all good points, but I didn't want to let this opportunity go by without thanking you and your colleagues in the Senate for the transportation package. Yeah. And as you know, freight mobility is hugely important to the ports competitiveness, both the Port of Seattle and Port of Tacoma, and fully funding the extensions of Route 167 and 509 are huge to us in terms of maintaining our competitiveness and our success well into the future. So thank you for all that.
I'll extend that to my colleagues as well. Yeah, I will be speaking to caucus on this. And
thank you.
Any other
Commissioner
questions?
I appreciate you taking the trip and coming to speak to us about the ports and the competitive issues, because it's purely a business issue. And I think that if we also keep in mind that our economic study showed that the Seaport Alliance was equivalent to about one-third the state's gross domestic product. This is not a Seattle-Tacoma issue. This is not really a Puget Sound issue. This is a state issue. And the whole state's at risk if we don't do this properly, and if we have trouble, like whether it's transportation or it's the competitiveness with the other state. So if we don't win these battles, the whole state will lose. It just won't be the Seaport Alliance. So I like the idea of taking it down to the state legislature and spreading this out so everybody becomes aware. Even though they're not directly involved, they will enjoy the success or they'll enjoy the failure, one way, however we decide to go.
So someone earlier, I think you mentioned labor. So in my speaking with labor, they've actually done some unionized of the workers and in the canal zone and so forth, and they're having a big, huge conclave. American labor is, I think they said March or April. Might be a fun time to try to go down. I don't know, but probably be the soonest I could go down. I'd like to accompany the group and make sure you get to talk with the American Chamber down there as well. I think that'd be
excellent.
Good. Yeah.
Okay. So we'll go down the road.
Thank you so much. Everybody has done that, but you put a lot of effort into this. It didn't just happen overnight, and that's what I thank you for the most, that you're on it and you're looking at it and you're really teaching yourself and and everybody around you, and that's really great that it isn't superficial. I guess my question to you is this. You spoke about the harbor maintenance fee, get us in or get us out. As you are aware, there's been an enormous amount of effort on the part of both ports and at every governmental level to get that to happen. Do you have any additional thoughts about, kind of pinning legislators down or any other way that we can move forward, even though with all of the effort that's been made, really nothing has changed? Senator Murray did some help for us, but bottom line, the difference and the non-competitive, the issues around competition are still there. Come in by land is cheaper, so why not go to Vancouver? So I'd like to hear if you have any specific or if you'd like to let us know about that.
No, well, first of all, I don't know what you've done so far except for what you just mentioned to me. But when I did make the inquiry, was told that it was, you know, hard in Congress because of the, and I mentioned this a little earlier, the strength in terms of numbers along the southern coast, and you, in politics, and that's what this is. This is a political battle. That's what this is. It's not a we're going to go do issues. It's we're going to go win the war, and you have to forget that and say that's not the way it should be. We're going to talk fairness. We're going to talk the United States of America, the third largest port, is going to get sucked up if we don't have some help here. You need to give attention to what's coming on, what's doing in the Pacific Northwest. And that means meeting with our senators and our members of Congress. It means a memorial to Congress. And one of the things I'll be doing in the legislature is proposing a memorial. And it would be really nice to have you guys feet on the ground going down and saying, look, we've got to do something. Get us in or get us out is what we need. And everyone sees the fairness or inequity in the situation that's there. It's not fair, and it's not treating people fairly. And even if you're from a southern port, and this is you got to put the guilt trip. Here's the guilt trip. What do you mean? You want to just benefit from the new widened canal and at the peril of the third largest port in this country, which is in a global economy? Is that to your advantage? The answer is no. And what do you do when you have the state that is number one economically dependent on trade? and you're just going to suck this out of us? You think that helps the rest by hurting us? The answer is no. You don't become stronger as a nation by letting a flat tire go. And that's what's going to happen. And it's a huge one. And I think someone over here mentioned how huge it is. So it's about getting aggressive. It's about getting this in the press. There are so many here that the writing of some Puget Sound Business Journal or the Times, or different places that you go and start to build the profile. With the help of labor, with the help of the citizens, because that's when people start to pay attention and the support is out there. I was I like to do projects where you have a lot of people liking stuff, and that's what this is. Mm-hmm. You'll have the support to help you.
Yeah, real quick, Senator, thank you very much for your support for us in the ports. I want to go back to the harbor maintenance tax real quick because we have been working real hard. We had a coalition of major big ports along the West Coast had tried to fight for this. One of the things that you're going to find out in the legislature is that there's a lot of ports, smaller ports, that rely on that. So you're not going to get the support completely from the legislature. So what I always looked at is that's fine. If we can't do that, then at least make it a level playing field by charging the same amount for goods coming into the United States, be it Mexico, be it Canada. So this way, everybody is going to benefit to some degree in that way. So I think if we went down that avenue, it might be a little bit better by getting support from the ports of Portland, Oregon, you talked about. They rely on the harbor maintenance tax greatly, Longview, Vancouver. So those are ports that will oppose the elimination of the harbor maintenance tax strictly for that.
Well, if you know, just politically in the state of Washington, there are 16 legislative districts in King County.
Right.
You know, and if people like me say, well, wait a minute, this isn't fair. I have no problem with Longview receiving back some of the harbor maintenance tax they put into it. They should get something back out. You see, so, and how many legislative districts do you think are down there? I don't want to pit the state against each other, but just to tell you that when you start talking about political strength just in our state, now that might be different another way. I guess this issue has not come up. It hasn't come up in the legislature. We are your helper people. I mean, not always, but sometimes we are. And so, so I think that you go down and figure out who your friends are and work with them and go get into the caucuses and let people know the problem and what are you focusing on? Well, you can focus on getting new clients. You can focus on getting the egg out of Eastern Washington, you know. And I mean, it just isn't as zippy as a fiddle. And the fiddle is to talk about the Panama Canal and the dire circumstances we'll be in if we don't do something now. So you focus on something that gets people's attention. And this is a true thing. No one has to make this up. So that's kind of how I would do the strategy of it. And I think when you consider we're starting again, we'll have committee weekend coming up November 16th, 17th, something like that. I don't think I have the calendar in front of me, but I think it's that week. And I'll be talking about this in my committee and working in caucus to find some people that are interested. There are other committees that will be interested in this. Obviously, we have a trade committee, for instance. And so I want to get people on board so they know what's going on. Thank you so much for your...
Oh, wait, there's more. There's just a little bit more.
Oh, okay. I'd be happy to. Yes, absolutely.
Thank you so much, Senator Roach. Really appreciate your enthusiasm and your approach to all of the issues that we face, because it's great to have that support. Two questions. I don't know what you meant by a memorial, so that was one question.
Okay.
And my other thought about this is HMT, other issues about trade, freight, and transportation really need to be part of a major national freight strategy, I think, in all of our opinions. And I love your idea of local press, but I also think it's vitally important that we expand the information that's spread to the national press beyond just the local press. It is a national issue.
Well, let me take them in reverse order. So one of the wonderful things about it having it be a national issue is what? The fact that it's going to be 2016 coming up. There are going to be people running for office, and they're hungry looking for support. And we're going to have national people coming in here. We need to talk to them in D.C. or wherever they are, get commitments from them before you give something to them. And that gets down to party stuff. I mean, you know, Republicans and Democrats are going to be supporting somebody eventually. And it's only a few months away. So we should be sending out letters to the various people of import in these parties and saying, look, we have a regional problem that needs to be addressed, and we'd like all of your candidates to address it.
Yes.
And then find it. You know, they're all going to say something. Put the pressure on and get the onus on one of them who's going to get elected. And when they're elected, we will have down. Who knows? But so, but we'll have them locked in. We'll have a statement from them. We'll have the parties already knowing that. Okay, now the other question was, what is a memorial? So we do different things down there. We pass laws and so forth. But we also have resolutions, and we have memorials. Memorials are to Congress. They're a wish list. They're a letter to Congress. But I think when you get everyone voting for it, and then you use that as an in-the-door tool, our state is supporting what, not just Seattle, not just the taxpayers in King County or Pierce County, but the people of the state of Washington are concerned. This, you know, so it's something to do. And it also brings up educating legislators, because when it's brought to the floor, I mean, I don't just get up and speak. I find people to speak for and with me. So we'll have Democrats and Republicans standing up on the floor talking about the needs. And that's one way you get it going. That's one way you get it going. And it takes a lot of work. I mean, somebody's got to be there to grab those quotes like this from what happened when that memorial passed, put it in a press release, get it out. So it's one by one thing like that. But we don't have time to draw out the issue. We have only a few months if we want to do the job well. And it's a big task, but I think that, I mean, I'd be happy to sit down and talk strategy with one of your lobbyists or one of you on what a timeline would look like in order to have some real things accomplished by the time we take our trip to Panama, which will be hopefully, we've decided if we want to go with our labor friends or not, but we would like their help, and they want us to help them. We're talking jobs. If you're talking about the Port of Tacoma, I mean, and there are whole different issues down there. You've got, you know, I'm talking to the port right now, but there are individual private industry that would like to come in and develop. They need vesting. There's a tribe. We are the only state in the country that has a tribe with property at a port. And I'm already working with them, and we need to work together, and I think that's how you do. This will be the one issue in the state of Washington where most of us, I think just about everyone's going to agree, and it's fun when that happens. It really makes you feel good inside to work on those kinds of projects.
I want my colleagues to know that the first time I really got to know the senator was, I think it was back in the 80s. If you'll recall, Senator, we actually were on the bus viewing the Alameda Corridor. Do you remember that?
Well, I remember that trip.
You didn't like your box lunch, I can tell you that much, because right. You gave it to me. But nonetheless, the fact is, wow, talk about refreshing. I mean, this is really good in terms of your next steps, the things you're talking about. But more importantly is a sincere thank you for your interest in ports, because you had that as an interest clear back in the 80s when we were viewing the Alameda Corridor. And one thing I remember talking with you at that time is my gosh, they had done a great job of pulling in resources from a variety of different entities, state, local, railroads, federal, and I believe that strategy is still an important strategy today. And so I really have a sincere appreciation for the partnership you're advocating that we need to do. It's a matter and a real sense of urgency, because we can't be sitting here. And for those of us that did go up to Canada, and I remember the quote from the Ministry of Transportation person saying that they were building an infrastructure capable of serving the needs, the global needs of North America. And as a person who owns a farm in South Dakota, and there's a lot of wheat and soybeans going out through Canada, and it kind of irritates me a little bit, to say the least. But nonetheless, I think the point here is that in partnership, we can accomplish a lot more. And your interest in trying to improve our infrastructure and our overall capability, I just want to say thank you. Again, this is refreshing, this is good, and I say thank you again.
Thank you very much. And I'll look forward to some, we'll do some follow-up, and I'll give you some dates on some of the things we'll be doing, okay?
Great. Fantastic. Thank you so much.
You bet. Thank you.
Appreciate you coming down.